Welcome back to my channel, Balance Sheets Matter. Today we're going to be looking at UPS, the shipping company that pretty much everyone around the world knows. This was a subscriber request video, so we're going to do a stock analysis on them. But before we get into this stock analysis, of course, make sure to subscribe to my channel, Balance Sheets Matter. I do individual stock analysis videos, so if you want to get ideas on potential good stocks to buy, value traps to avoid, you know, subscribe to the channel. And if you do want me to look at a stock, you know, you can leave it in the comments below because I do frequently get the subscriber requests, such as UPS, which we're covering today, and a lot of these other ones, which I have done recently as well. Now, let's dive into the analysis, start looking at UPS. Let's look at some of these top level metrics that they show on the first page of Groove Focus here. They got their little Groove Focus value band, and you can see they're not a big growth company, but it is saying they could be a little bit undervalued. Currently, right now, their PE is sitting at about a 19 with a little bit of a forward PE ratio of 17.7. We're going to have to see if that's expensive or cheap for UPS. And they have a nice dividend. So, you know, those dividend investors probably would be interested in the stock with a 4.37% dividend. But that does come with a fairly high payout ratio of 0.75. And I'm going to get into that a little bit more later about what to expect for that in the future. So let's dive into the financials now. You can basically see here the overall like long-term revenue trend, you know, has been about 7%. We can see last 10 years is 7% here. And, you know, effectively the EPS has grown a little bit faster because they've done a little bit of share buybacks, but they're not the quickest grower, but they are very consistent because they're one of the big shipping companies along with FedEx. And so as the economy grows, as shipping grows, as inflation grows, well, their prices are going to go up and, you know, people are going to continue using them. So let's look at the revenue now. You can see basically over longer term, the revenue has been going up, but there has been a little pullback in the revenue. From 2020 to 2022, there was a very big increase, and now this is pulled back from $100 billion to $90 billion. And this is kind of interesting because if you look in the history from 2008 to 2009, there was also a pullback there. So a little bit of not, well, it's not an official recession. A lot of people with inflation have been feeling those recessionary vibes. And, you know, maybe we're seeing that a little bit with UPS as well. So we see the gross margin. Effectively, you look back here, that how they've done their accounting has changed a little bit. So we don't want to look at that. But you can see they are at about 19%, which has been pretty consistent. They sometimes fluctuate a little bit lower, sometimes a little bit higher. So all considering that there has been a pullback in revenue and they are able to still maintain their gross margin, even though in the past it sometimes is a point or two higher, I would say they are maintaining their competitive moat. They aren't losing any basically market share from there. If anything, you know, maybe they're gaining a little bit because, you know, I'm starting to use UPS more myself in my business as well. They offer, you know, great rates, great service. I know a lot of people who use it as well. And you can see basically the operating margin here. Well, it does fluctuate a little bit up and down. It's typically around 10%, a little bit higher, a little bit lower. And then again, this is also with the same issue of that your other basically operating expenses is typically going to go up over time. And they have had a dip in revenue temporarily, at least, hopefully, like, well, from the projections, they are expected to go back up, which has in the short term squeezed their operating margins down a little bit. So considering there's this contraction of revenue, we still have the operating margins at 10%. This is still quite strong, historically speaking, because they have been lower before, and we probably could expect this to see this rise a little bit back up in the future as the revenue scales up and hopefully the other operating expenses here go up at a little bit of a slower pace. Next thing to look at is basically the interest expense. This is one thing that I think is very good for UPS here because their operating income right now, even though it has declined over the last few years, is still sitting over $9 billion. And the interest expense is only $785 million. That's kind of keeping what I like to look at, the 1 to 10 ratio of having very good coverage for your interest expense and basically signifying a strong balance sheet before you even look at the balance. So, you know, they're looking really good in those regards there. One thing you do need to keep an eye out for, which kind of throws people off and may have value traps of people in 21, 2022, is when you have these other income expenses, because these are typically one-time adjustments, not really cash related, and they can really inflate your revenue to look really high or really inflated to look really low. So things have got about normalized now. So probably what we're seeing is a fairly accurate representation, but probably in 2021, 2022, they were looking really cheap. Their revenue was a lot higher, margins were on the high side, and they also had these other operating basically incomes that were inflating their earnings probably far above what really they are making at the bottom line. But we go down, we see over the long run, EPS has been going up. This was sort of scream something was abnormal when you're going from, say, 2019 in the $5 range, suddenly the $14 and $13 there, and now it's come back down 781, but if you look from the longer term perspective, this is a big increase over the years. It is going definitely head in the right direction of providing value to shareholders, EPS, even positive, even in 2008, 2009, during the Great Recession there, they still did have positive EPS. So that is a very good sign for them. And over the period of time there too, they have slowly been buying back stocks. So this is a very solid stock. From everything we've seen so far, it just really comes down to what the price is. But we're going to now dive into the balance sheet, see if we've noticed any pros or cons there. You can see right now, total current assets sitting just over $19 billion. A lot of it is some accounts receivable, a little bit of cash and cash equivalents, nothing, you know, too unordinary. And total liabilities a little bit lower, so they have a current ratio above one, which, you know, for them actually really wouldn't matter too much, but they're going to can easily meet all their short-term obligations. So, you know, pretty standard there. Total assets sitting at about just over $70 billion. They do have goodwill of just under $5 billion, so we should factor that out. And you can also see a lot, they do have a lot of basically gross property, plant, and equipment, stuff like that. They have some depreciated some, but they have basically total long-term assets of about $51 billion, which as I get a little bit further in this analysis, I want to circle back to a little bit talking about that. And you can see total liabilities sitting at $53 billion here. Their total long-term liabilities are only $35 billion. And you can see they do just have under $20 billion of debt, which really isn't too much of a big deal because that's very easy serviceable debt for them. And there is a little bit of, you know, capital leases that they have to pay as well. So that leaves them with $17 billion of stockholder equity, but about $5 billion at least as goodwill. You knock that off, leaving them with $12 billion, which is a positive number, saying there's kind of a surplus on their balance sheet, about $12 billion. But as we get into the cash flow statement next, I'm going to kind of show how that may be potentially a little bit misleading and not actually the full case that there's that much sitting there. Though not saying there's anything bad about their balance sheet. I think it's actually quite good. We know their debt's manageable. There's nothing that seems to be a problem, but I think this can be a little bit deceiving of the total equity we are seeing, because we get into the cash flow statement. And one of the things I like to look at is basically what is your cash flow from depreciation and what is your purchase of plant, property, and equipment. And you're going to notice a very consistent trend here where the purchase of plant, property, and equipment is very consistently, almost for their entire like 15-year history here that I'm seeing, is higher than their cash flow from depreciation. So basically, they're having to replace their equipment, their UPS trucks and whatever other machinery at a faster pace than the depreciation schedule. And just seeing this as a very consistent trend going back into history, well, there's a few times when it's lower, but much more consistently, it is higher. I haven't figured out the exact percentage, but it looks maybe up to 30% there. That surplus we're seeing on the balance sheet of these long-term assets probably isn't really viable long-term assets, because they actually are having to replace them a little bit faster. You can see also they do a little bit of a purchase of businesses, little acquisitions of probably smaller brokerage and other logistics companies, but this isn't a huge part of their business in comparison to the purchase of plant, property, and equipment. But it is just good to keep in mind that they are having a little bit of expend there. So when you are seeing the EPS, you do have to factor in that these EPS numbers are probably a little bit high, because basically through their purchase of plant, property, equipment, and other purchases of businesses, those pretty much are always going to be exceeding, at least from what I'm seeing here and the last 15 years, what they're depreciating, meaning their actual EPS, when we factor this in, is going to be a little bit lower. So something to keep in mind, not a bad thing, just the reality of what's happening on their cash flow statement here. So next we look at, they do repurchase a good amount of stock. There is a little bit of stock issuance here, very minor. I think that maybe, I don't think that's relating to the stock-based compensation, but you can see they also do some stock-based compensation here, which has dramatically reduced down. For whatever reason, maybe because there was the big boom in shipping, there was some really high stock-based compensation here, which was a little bit unfortunate, but it has kind of reduced down quite a bit here, but it may creep back up, because in the past history, it was about $500-600 million. So we probably would expect to see that revert back to that trend in the future, unless there's been a very significant change in how their payroll and compensation does. So I haven't looked too much into their reports there about that, but that is something that probably if you really do want to buy UPS, you should investigate a little bit more to get a good idea of what the projection of that stock-based compensation would be. But you can see overall, they do consistently repurchase back stock over the years. They have repurchased a lot back in the last year. here as well. And they do pay, now getting into the dividend things, they do pay a fairly big dividend. And you'll kind of notice that the reason why this dividend is so high is in this 2021 going into 2022, when they were seeing those a little bit abnormally higher profits, they really started paying a lot higher dividends. So we kind of are jumping from, you know, just low $3 billion to over $5 billion, which I think is a little bit abnormally high, and they're probably paying too high of a dividend. But I don't see for them with such a strong balance sheet, they would actually even have to cut it. But if you look at the free cash flow here, which, you know, factors in those purchase of plant, property, equipment, and other expenses there, these cash flow, the dividends for, like, from the cash flow statement here are exceeding that right now. So, well, they probably will be able to start beating it. This might mean in the short term, they might have to take on a little bit of a debt because they got a little bit higher in their dividend. So I wouldn't be expecting any significant dividend raises in the foreseeable future. So they'll probably keep paying it because they can. They have access to cheap debt, and their interest expense is already pretty low, and companies really don't like cutting dividends if they don't have to, because it's a really bad look. So they'll probably keep this high, but I would not expect any significant dividend increases in the future. Now let's jump into the interactive chart here, do my little version of a relative analysis. And this is also going to kind of show you something on the dividend, why, when you're doing these types of relative analysis, is you have to look at the financials and look for abnormalities like that to kind of see what that past history. So I'm going to bring up the dividend yield right now. And typically when I would look at this, I would say, hey, look, very high dividend. This means past historical points, it's a really good buy. But I think this dividend is higher than it should be. And that does not mean, therefore, it's at an extreme bottom right now. So let's look at a few of the other metrics here. Let's basically look at the revenue with estimate, pop up the EPS with estimate. And you can see basically both expected increase on this long-term trend. And take the revenue from estimate away here. And you can see EPS with estimates been increasing pretty steadily over the long term. So that 7% they were, you know, doing in the past, pretty likely they're going to kind of keep in par with that. And with their dividend, what yield do you get on average at the end of the day? The stock's increasing between their growth and their dividend increase, you know, ends up being about 11% or so. So that's kind of, if you bought it at fair value, you can maybe expect to receive 11% going on in the future. And then we pop up the price to sales ratio. You can see the price to sales ratio starts speaking a little bit more truth than the dividend yield, as the dividend yield we were seeing comparable to these extreme lows here. But right now, the price to sales ratio is not sitting there, and it's sitting a little bit more in kind of the middle range here, a little bit at that fairer value kind of going 2008 going forward. So I'm going to now go into the stock chart here, give a little look over that. And well, some people like technical analysis, other don't. This is technical analysis blended in with the fundamentals, because this stock trend here is actually with the real actual revenue growth of the company itself. If you actually measure this out here, show you that and kind of give you an idea of where I actually get these channels that I always do from to kind of project things, is that it's at about that 6-7% range. And what have we seen for the last 10 years? We've seen about 7.3% revenue growth. So it's no surprise that the overall trend of the stock is going up at about 7.3%. So right now you can see, based on the fundamental analysis I was looking at there, it was looking like okay, but I think the value is a little bit high, even though the dividend or the PE is showing at a 17.74, which you might say, hey, that's starting to look a little cheap. Remember, basically all the extra purchase of plant, property, equipment, and cash flow is actually a little bit higher. So stock right now, I think, is more around fair value, even a little bit, be hypothetically a touch undervalued, but I do think it's hovering more around fair value. And right now, from a fundamental and technical standpoint, I would only be really be interested in buying UPS when it gets around to $120 here. This would be a much better valuation, provide much better basically upside, and is also, from a technical perspective, looks like a very good point to buy. Because what do you have? You have the big price price volume profile here from all this previous consolidation, so that's going to provide support. You also have these lower moving averages with the line with where previous dips have been. So that's personally where I'm looking at buying UPS. Depending on what your goals are, if you're buying it right here, maybe in the long term, you can yield about that 10-11%. But typically myself, I like to look for yields a lot higher. So at this point, while the trend would be going up at that, say, 10-11% between your dividend and your actual growth, you're also, when you're buying it down here, you're getting a lot of also just undervaluation upside as well, which kind of gives those extra gains. So Anyways, I do have UPS on my watch list. I'm looking at it under $120. For the amount of slow growth they have, I think it's a little bit expensive right now because UPS, as I've mentioned with their previous other stuff, they kind of can give that illusion that they are cheap due to the PE ratio, which sometimes is a little bit abnormally high because of the past few years, or because of that basically purchase of plant, property, and equipment, meaning the their actual like EPS should probably be a little bit lower. And also the fact that dividend yield looks really high, but I think they raised it too quickly and they're not going to be raising it that quickly anytime soon. So overall, I hope you like this analysis. I hope it gave you some insights into EPS. If you do want me to look at a stock in the future, leave it in the comments below. As you know, I do often get to them, and I'll see you in the next stock analysis video. Remember to subscribe to Balance Sheets Matter.